Moving to wide receiver, we're going to emphasize something different. Running back, we wanted tight games. At wide receiver, we want high-scoring games. Because at wide receiver, 67% of all players in perfect lineups came from games with a total of 45 or higher. That is compared to 55% of all games across the NFL. That's a big number. What's more startling to me is that only one out of 57 perfect wide receivers came from a game with a total under 40. Game environment is key everywhere. Mentioned it at quarterback and stacking, but wide receivers need a lot of volume to pay off. And a lot of times, game environments are worse and totals are lower because there'll be less play volume throughout the entire day. And we want to make sure we are definitely downgrading guys in games with low totals as a result of this. So again, I'm not saying you cross those games off, but if someone down there with a low total is in your core, ask yourself if that game will hit the over. If it's not going to hit the over, then you're going to want to reconsider and look elsewhere. The other super interesting thing at wide receiver was the difference between the expensive wide receivers and the cheap ones. Basically, the cheaper guys were big play, high variance wide receivers, and the expensive ones were more dependent on volume. The way we can see this is by looking at how they got their points. There were 22 wide receivers with a salary below $6,000. Those 22 guys averaged 18.3 yards per reception in the games where they made the perfect lineup. The more expensive wide receivers averaged 16.6 yards per reception. It's a major split, but it also makes a lot of sense because players with high ADOTs who get a lot of downfield targets are going to be more volatile. They get lower percentage targets, which means there is a good chance they have a poor game. And when you have a poor game, that lowers your salary. But they still have the ability to hit the highs, which is key for something like a perfect lineup. It's also backed up when you look at some of the names on this list. The cheaper wide receivers who made perfect lineups were DeSean Jackson in week one, his lone week where he was healthy. Marquise Brown was there. John Brown was there. DJ Chark, Marvin Jones, John Ross. None of those guys are elite wide receivers, but they get downfield looks and can convert on long catches, and that gives them a path to a big game. But I think what's emphasizing, though, is that even the cheaper wide receivers needed the ability to have a big game. And the scoring thing is key here as it was at quarterback. The first time we did this study and looking at perfect lineups was back in 2017. And we set a criteria for wide receivers to make the perfect lineup. They basically needed to get either 85 receiving yards or score two touchdowns. And last year, one wide receiver was an exception. It was Danny Amendola. I remember this because Danny Amendola is the bane of my existence. He was the one guy who was an exception. This year, there was only one exception as well. That was in week 17, Dede Westbrook made the perfect line without getting either 85 receiving yards or two touchdowns. But it happened in week 17, where scoring is lower. So I think this is still a good set of criteria and a good way to decide whether a wide receiver has the upside to make it in your lineup. Can they get to 85 receiving yards, or can they score twice? If you can't answer yes to one of those two questions, you probably should not use that wide receiver in a tournament. I would probably not want to use them in a cash game either, because upside does matter there as well. But it's mostly important when you're looking for upside, 85 yards or two touchdowns, that's what you need out of your wide receiver to justify using them. So wide receiver and perfect lineups, we wanted higher scoring games. We wanted to desperately avoid bad games. And I think that's more key at wide receiver than any other single position on the board. For the cheaper receivers, you want big play guys. I tend to prefer them at home where they may be more likely to hit on those deep plays, but that was not necessarily as true in the data this year as it was last year. And you do want to make sure all receivers, regardless of salary, have a path to a ceiling game, 85 receiving yards or two touchdowns. If they can't get that, you're best looking elsewhere.